I have seen computer science researchers who look like they are working on something groundbreaking, looking as if they were on the verge of a major discovery. They spend days, months, and sometimes years investigating and discussing research ideas. Then, in the best cases, they start to write code, run experiments, and collect results. And then, everything looks great. The findings get published in a prestigious journal or conference. But here is the thing. Very often, that so-called novel research is either worthless or just doesn't work as claimed. According to some studies on this topic, over 75% of the results published in prestigious computer science journals are just not reproducible at all. Link in the description of this video, by the way. And unfortunately, this is not just a small issue. This is actually a big problem for science. So today, we are diving into the idea of cargo-cult science, which is a term coined by the legendary Richard Feynman to describe the very problem that is hitting hard in modern research. And trust me, it is a wild ride, so you don't want to miss out. In 1974, Feynman gave a very memorable commencement speech at Caltech University. And to be honest, I think this is probably one of the greatest speeches about science of all time. Feynman compared modern scientific practices to the cargo cult rituals of Melanesian and Micronesian societies during World War II. There, the native of these islands saw soldiers building runways and control towers, and then planes would land, bringing valuable goods. So after the war, they built their own runways and control towers, hoping the planes and the cargo would return. But here's what happened. The planes never came. The cargo never arrived. Why? Because the natives were missing the underlying principles of what made those planes land in the first place. This situation sounds ridiculous, right? But Feynman's point was that many scientists today are doing the exact same thing. They are following the rituals of science without truly understanding or applying the scientific method. And when the planes don't land, they are left scratching their heads, wondering what went wrong. Now, let's talk about the similarities of this with poor science, or as Feynman called it, pseudoscience. These are the flashy headline-grabbing claims that often turn out to be nothing more than wishful thinking, or even worse, seemingly intentional deception. For example, take the infamous case of cold fusion in 1989, when two electrochemists claimed they had achieved nuclear fusion at room temperature. Such a discovery, of course, could have potentially led to a revolution in energy production. But spoiler alert, it was too good to be true. The results couldn't be replicated. The whole thing turned out to be a classic case of junk science. And indeed, today, cold fusion is a synonym of bad science, to say the least. Just another example in the field of computer science. You still remember the early days of deep learning. That was at the end of the last century. Because, you know, the core concepts of deep learning are actually older than what most people know. So, well, I remember that there were bold claims about AI models being able to teach themselves complex tasks without human intervention. And again, it sounds amazing. Until people realize that these models fail to generalize outside of the carefully curated training data. And this is why it is crucial for us to reproduce our results. If our experiments cannot be repeated by others, it is not science that we are making, actually. And we should call it instead cargo cult science. So there is no need to invent a new term for it, because Feynman alerted us about this issue decades ago. He said that true scientific integrity means being utterly honest, reporting all the data, which includes all the stuff that doesn't support our hypothesis. According to my experience, I have seen that too many researchers today are just ignoring this advice. This brings us to what I believe is the heart of the problem, the reproducibility crisis. So let's talk about it. The essence of making science is that the results must be verifiable. This means that other researchers should be able to repeat our experiments and get the exact same results. But in computer science, as well as in many other fields, this just isn't happening how it should be. Just think about it. How can we reproduce results from 5 years ago when the hardware used back then doesn't even exist anymore? Running the software with the exact same configuration is almost impossible. And sure, tools like Docker may help, but what guarantee do we have that Docker will be even around in the next 20 or 30 years? Here is the real deal. Many researchers today dare to admit that the results they publish might just be the outcome of a lucky run of the code. As when one graduate student managed to get a plot that looks good and boom, here you got it. A month after, the paper is published. So given the status quo, we need to take reproducibility more seriously. I personally expect to see a link to the source code or to the raw results of every paper I read, along with the list of instructions on how to build it. And if I could not find such a link, then I became very skeptical about the validity of the research being done. The pressure to publish or perish is another major factor driving cargo cult science. I have mentioned this many times in academia. The race for grants, tenure, and recognition can push even the most well-intentioned researchers into the trap of prioritizing quantity over quality. This pressure has, unfortunately, given rise to certain forms of academic misconduct, including paper mills, where existing research is put all together to create something new that might get published, even if it doesn't have real value. And it is not just computer science. In fields like medicine, entire bodies of research have been retracted after being exposed as fraudulent. I believe that the problem is systemic, and it is driven by a culture that values publications over true scientific contributions. Coming back to Feynman, he lamented that the kind of integrity he talked about wasn't baked into the scientific education system from the beginning. I'm afraid that the situation hasn't changed that much since then, and academic institutions hope students will get it by osmosis. But in reality, I think they should be much more proactive in teaching these principles. So, how do we fix this? How do we avoid falling into the traps of cargo cult science? The answer lies in rigor, rigorous methodology, rigorous analysis, and most importantly, rigorous honesty. As a rule of thumb, if the results seem too good to be true, they probably aren't true. We must be our own harshest critics, criticizing our work with the same intensity we used to criticize someone else's papers. We need to foster a culture of integrity and transparency in research, And early career researchers especially need guidance on the ethical dimensions of the scientific work. It is not that I fully understand the scope of ethical implications sections included in many PhD theses. On the other hand, we should also encourage reproducibility by rewarding, with submission acceptance, the replications of studies and the sharing of even negative results. Community and collaboration are also crucial. We need to shift from a competitive to more collaborative environment, where sharing methods, findings, and validations are encouraged rather than discouraged. And this will hopefully get reduced the isolation that often leads to unethical shortcuts. So ultimately, it is up to us to make sure that science remains a bastion of truth and integrity, not a cargo cult ritual. So it is clear that Feynman's message is as relevant today as it was 50 years ago. And to be a real scientist, not a cargo cult scientist, we all must follow the principles of integrity, getting our fundamentals clear, staying away from quick results with superficial learning, and more importantly, having skin in the game. Feynman ended his speech with a powerful wish for all of us to find the freedom to maintain our integrity, to be in a place where we don't feel forced to compromise our principles for the sake of our careers. May you have that freedom. See you in the next one. Bye.